Look at all that news back there. Look at all that fake news.
It's hard to forget Donald Trump's time in office.
President Putin was extremely strong and powerful in his denial today.
Build that wall. Build that wall. Build that wall.
But what impact did his presidency and his policies really have?
You just cannot underestimate how much Donald Trump has reshaped America.
Waiting down there in the heart of that big hall, we can hear the chants of USA, Hannah.
Thank you.
Trump's election victory in 2016 shocked many.
I'm without words. I don't know what's happening in this country.
And defied what the polls had predicted.
This is what the picture of the US is going to look like, if those polls are to be believed. Can we believe the polls?
He won by promising to make America great again, a message that resonated with white, working-class Americans and nearly a third of Asian and Hispanic voters. And on the 20th of January 2017, the former reality TV star became America's 45th president.
Inauguration Day felt totally surreal. After months of fire and brimstone on the campaign trail, suddenly you had this really conventional moment. Donald Trump was surrounded by the old guard of Washington, the swamp, as he calls it. And all they could do was listen to his vision of the future.
From this day forward, it's going to be only America first. America first.
Oftentimes, when there is unemployment and upset, people turn particularly populist and anti-elitist.
The jobs left and the factories closed. The establishment protected itself.
We can't dismiss the fact that he won three key states of Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin. And those tend to be viewed as so-called Rust Belt states, where a lot of industry has fled to other countries. There are a lot of blue-collar working-class people. And it was to Donald Trump they turned, and it was to them that he had pitched his platform.
What do you want to hear from Donald Trump? Do you want something fresh?
We want to see history made today, and we want our jobs brought back.
The transition of power may have been peaceful, but on the streets of Washington, D.C., protesters threw bricks, smashed windows, and were met with tear gas.
He is not our president. The American people did not elect him. We do not support his presidency.
I think he's misogynistic. I think he's a sexist pig.
The next day, millions took part in women's marches around the world. In his first month, Trump signed a long list of executive orders to undo the policies of Barack Obama and to fulfill some of his campaign promises. This included the controversial travel ban, barring citizens from Iran, Iraq, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, Syria, and Yemen from entering the US for 90 days.
It's not a Muslim ban, but we're totally prepared. It's working out very nicely. You see it at the airports, you see it all over. It's working out very nicely.
The travel ban was hugely controversial. Donald Trump said that it was designed to protect America from terrorism, but his opponents said it was a war on Muslims.
This executive order was mean-spirited and un-American.
His followers felt heard.
It would be, in my opinion, we should ban all Muslims. Why create a new problem? We have enough of them.
His opponents were incredulous.
It's giving the message that America and the West hate Muslims, and we're here to say, no, our problem is not with Islam or Muslims.
Donald Trump always said that he would impose this ban. Why do you think there's surprise?
I'm still totally confused that this is the America that we live in now.
As part of Trump's America First agenda, the US reevaluated many of its international commitments and alliances.
Trump was desperate to restore and showcase America's strength. He scorned multilateral agencies in favor of a return to raw power.
This included withdrawing from the Trans-Pacific Partnership.
Great thing for the American worker, what we just did.
Leaving the UN Human Rights Council.
We take this step because our commitment does not allow us to remain a part of a hypocritical and self-serving organization that makes a mockery of human rights.
Exiting the Paris Climate Agreement.
Our withdrawal
from the agreement represents a reassertion of America's sovereignty.
And leaving the Iran nuclear deal.
The fact is, this was a horrible one-sided deal that should have never, ever been made.
He pursued a brute protectionism, but he also negotiated trade pacts with Canada and Mexico. Ultimately, it felt like he did achieve a strong degree of America first, but at times it also felt like an America alone with its allies no longer certain of their relationships.
These deals that we talk about and these institutions, most of them are completely useless. And agreements that are made between different countries on the basis of their own sovereign national interests tend to last and be more beneficial for the world. So I think Trump's policy of withdrawing from many of these institutions and agreements actually made the United States stronger and not weaker.
He also urged NATO allies to pay more for their security.
NATO members must finally contribute their fair share and meet their financial obligations.
Well, I don't think it matters to Trump whether he alienated U.S. allies. And it was right to say that many members were not meeting the commitment they had voluntarily made after Russia invaded Ukraine the first time in 2014. So what Trump was saying wasn't new necessarily. What was new was the threat that he would withdraw the United States from NATO, which I think would be a catastrophic mistake. But in Trump's mind, it's a ledger sheet question.
You're getting the protection of the U.S. and the greatest military force in the world, and you're not paying. You're delinquent. So I tell some people they're delinquent. Not everybody can love that.
Well, I've compared it to trying to work inside a pinball machine. It didn't work like any White House that I had ever had contact with before. It doesn't follow the normal orderly rhythms of decision making, certainly not in the national security space. He came from the Trump Organization, which is actually a very small operation. And I think he tried to replicate that inside the government.
In a break with traditional U.S. foreign policy, Trump sought out unlikely friendships.
For a man who kept talking about America first, it was actually Donald Trump's perceived bromance with Vladimir Putin that engulfed Washington for years.
Vladimir Putin does not share our interests. Vladimir Putin does not share our values.
We need hearings as soon as possible to assess what President Trump might have committed to President Putin in secret.
His campaign was accused of conspiring with Russian agents to influence the U.S. election.
But this is what the end result is.
He said it was a nothing burger, but his opponents were incredulous at the thought of a grave threat to American democracy from a Cold War enemy.
At a summit with Vladimir Putin in 2018, Trump backed the Russian president over the issue of election meddling.
He just said it's not Russia. I will say this, I don't see any reason why it would be.
Well, I think Trump completely misreads Vladimir Putin and Xi Jinping and Kim Jong-un. He thinks that if he has a good personal relationship with the head of a foreign government, particularly an adversary of the United States, that means U.S. relations with that country are good. He doesn't appreciate that the other leaders have a very cold-blooded view of what their national interests are and intend to pursue them, and that they don't view him as a close personal friend. They view him as a very easy mark.
Vladimir Putin did not invade anything for the 4 years that Trump was president. It was actually a unique period of calm. He invaded Georgia under George W. Bush. He took Crimea under Barack Obama. And under Biden, of course, he invaded Ukraine. But nothing happened. When Trump was president, there was this understanding that Putin would not do anything. And behind that understanding, it wasn't just smiles and handshakes. It was also tough sanctions on the Nord Stream 2 pipeline. There was military action against Russian mercenaries in Syria. So there was an iron fist inside the velvet glove, if you will. And the same with North Korea.
Inside here, seasoned U.S. diplomats were meeting with the North Korean delegation to decide what, if any, kind of deal and detail they can agree on. I was in Singapore to see the meeting with Pyongyang's strongman, and it felt absolutely wild. We'd had months of these insults like little Rocket Man.
Rocket Man is on a suicide mission for himself.
And there was talk of war games.
They will be met with fire and fury like the world has never seen.
And then suddenly we heard about an exchange of love letters between the two men.
He wrote me beautiful letters, and they're great letters. We fell in love.
It felt like an intense piece of performance theater. It was really interesting to write to the body language between the two men.
It's my honor today to address the people of the world following this very historic summit with Chairman Kim Jong-un.
I didn't think it was the right thing to do. I think it was giving credibility and stature to a dictator of a rat's-ass little country that we should have been squeezing harder, not negotiating with. And I think it gave Kim legitimacy, and I think it gave him stature, and I think it gave him space to continue his nuclear weapons program.
It didn't really result in any major change. He didn't get the nuclear disarmament commitment that he wanted. If anything, it was far more spectacle than substance.
In the Middle East, Trump rolled out a maximum pressure strategy against Iran, reimposing economic sanctions on the country's banking, oil, and shipping industries.
The Iran nuclear deal was designed to bring Iran into international negotiations, and the goal was to restrict Iran's production of uranium that then could be turned into nuclear weapons.
Because an Iran armed with a nuclear weapon would be far more destabilizing and far more dangerous to our friends and to the world. Consider what happens in a world without this deal.
Now, in my judgment, reviewing the evidence, that agreement was working. And when Trump entered office, he negated that agreement. And he was listening to people like John Bolton. His advisors just gave him horrible advice. And as a result, Iran is very near the ability to create and make use of a nuclear weapon.
Will you admit now that withdrawing from the Iran nuclear deal was a mistake?
Well, the only mistakes we made were not carrying through and finally assisting the people of Iran to overthrow the Iranian regime. It's certainly the continuation of that regime in power in Tehran right now, implementing what they themselves call their Ring of Fire strategy, unleashing terrorist proxies the Houthis in Yemen, Hamas in the Gaza Strip, Hezbollah in Lebanon, Shia militia groups in Iraq and Syria against Israel. There has never been a single indication that Iran or North Korea ever made a strategic decision not to pursue nuclear weapons, deals or no deals.
Appealing to his evangelical base, Trump reversed decades of U.S. foreign policy on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict.
It is time to officially recognize Jerusalem as the capital of Israel.
The Palestinian leadership has called the actions of Donald Trump reprehensible. It says that the Americans have abandoned all neutrality and they can have no place now in the Middle East peace process.
The U.S. in particular should be serving as a source of peacemaking and diplomacy. And it's unfortunate that the Trump administration and the Biden administration failed to cultivate a better diplomatic relationship between Israel and the Palestinians and between the U.S. and the Palestinians.
Donald Trump was the first American president in many administrations not to go to war. More than that, he also achieved the historic Abraham Accords in the Middle East, a series of peace agreements between Israel and Arab and Muslim states. These connections have remained solid. And if you go to Dubai or Abu Dhabi, there are solid Jewish communities there that feel very safe in the United Arab Emirates. And that's been a success.
I didn't know I was going to be given a prop.
At home, Trump focuses energy on trade, border security, repealing Obama's healthcare plan, and on the economy, introducing sweeping tax cuts. In 2018, Mr. Trump announced tariffs on Chinese imports entering the US, triggering a trade war between the world's two largest economies.
He had tariffs that protected American industry without significantly raising the overall level of prices in the United States. Inflation remained very low.
We put a lot of tariffs on China today, as you know. They put some on us. We put a lot on them.
Now, there were some American industries that suffered from retaliation from China, like agriculture, for example.
They want to hit the farmers because they think that hits me. I wouldn't say that's nice, but I tell you, our farmers are great patriots. These are great patriots. They understand they're doing this for the country.
Even though people still talk about tariffs as a bad thing, and I would agree that in the extreme, they are certainly a bad thing, Trump actually opened our eyes to the ways in which tariffs can be used, first of all, to protect domestic industry, but also to achieve foreign policy goals.
The Trump administration also faced multiple scandals.
And there were so many firsts under his presidency. We saw him embrace people on the fringes. He was accused of courting white supremacists.
We condemn in the strongest possible terms this egregious display of hatred, bigotry, and violence on many sides. On many sides.
There was also a rapid revolving door. Anthony Scaramucci, head of communications, out in just 11 days. Michael Flynn forced to resign because of his ties with the Russian government. Every Friday, it felt like we would wait to see who was in and who was out. It was like a constant soap opera.
Why did you fire the director, call me?
Because he wasn't doing a good job, very simply. He was not doing a good job.
You've said that you resigned from your role as national security advisor, but Donald Trump says he fired you. What's the truth?
Well, the fact is I submitted my resignation and the morning of September the 10th. The mistake I made was not engaging in a little preemption of my own. I gave the president the courtesy of giving him the resignation letter, and I should have tweeted out immediately that that's what I had done.
You had a man that was able to completely reshape the political landscape. While everyone in Washington was aghast at some of his behavior, the tenor of what he said, he was actually able to make some real concrete change, like three Supreme Court justices.
So now on the US Supreme Court, there is not only a Republican majority of justices, but a very conservative majority of justices. And that in part was how Donald Trump came to be elected, because he vowed reaching out to white Christian evangelicals in the United States, meeting them where they were on the issue of abortion.
This led to the reversal of the court's 1973 Roe v. Wade decision, which blocked individual states from banning abortion.
This is part of the Republican Party's dark vision for America. They want to roll back every possible right that has been earned over the decades. It is an anti-woman agenda.
I'm so happy!
It's a blessing, it's a miracle for God.
Well, to the US now, where the number of coronavirus deaths has passed 100,000. For many, it is a time of economic uncertainty and of mourning.
In his last year in office, Trump was faced with a growing health crisis and accusations that he had initially downplayed COVID-19.
The risk to the American people remains very low.
Looks like by April, you know, in theory, when it gets a little warmer, it miraculously goes away. I hope that's true.
And then I see the disinfectant where it knocks it out in a minute, 1 minute. And is there a way we can do something like that?
This was at a critical time for the president, who was seeking re-election.
Or are you concerned that downplaying the virus maybe got some people sick?
And a lot of people love Trump, right? A lot of people love him. You see him all the time, right?
Even though he helped to get the vaccine developed in record time against COVID, he was not among the strongest advocates for people getting the vaccine, even though he ultimately took it, having gotten COVID.
I'm going to Walter Reed Hospital. I think I'm doing very well.
If he's sick, we're going to support him, you know, in his reelection, and in, we have prayers for him.
Our president is one of the hardest working pro-American presidents we've ever had.
I think the pandemic felt like his Achilles heel, that if it hadn't happened, he could have won the election.
Trump was at a golf course when US TV networks declared Joe Biden as the winner of the 2020 election. He initially refused to concede and tweeted, "I won this election by a lot."
Joe Biden could have voted 50 times, as far as we know, or 5,000 times.
4 days after the election was held, Trump's team hosted a press conference at the Four Seasons Total Landscaping.
You might remember the Trump campaign accidentally booking the Four Seasons Landscaping Company next to a sex shop rather than the hotel.
Philadelphia, unfortunately, and I would say this about my own city, has a reputation for voter fraud. You have a reputation for dead people voting, and we're going to go look at just how many dead people voted here.
2 months after the election defeat, Trump repeated allegations of voter fraud at a Save America rally in Washington, D.C.
I said, something's wrong here. Something's really wrong. Can't have happened. And we fight. We fight like hell. And if you don't fight like hell, you're not going to have a country anymore.
Hours later, supporters of Trump forced their way into the U.S. Capitol building in an attempt to stop the confirmation of Joe Biden's election victory.
You had this sacred building suddenly stormed, the specter of that, the legacy. What it showed not only America but the rest of the world, I think, shocked people to their core.
I have to say I've worked in all three branches of government, so I've been in all of the sacred buildings of the American government. And I couldn't believe my eyes. It hurt my heart to see people ravage it and be so bloodthirsty, calling for the hanging of the vice president, Mike Pence, under Trump. It was a dark day in American history that I, in my view, threw it back to our Civil War.
Do you think you've made your point here, Mel?
No, I don't think they understand.
The American people are very generous towards past presidents. And certainly as years go by, Americans seem to shroud in kind of a golden glow past presidents. I don't know whether that will happen for Donald Trump, that someday people will look back and see it as a golden age of the Trump era from his first term. But I do know what scholars think, and scholars always rank George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, and Franklin Roosevelt as the greatest presidents. But right now, scholars put Donald Trump at the bottom of the rankings. And as a scholar and a presidential oral historian, I have to agree with them.
Trump is certainly not the worst president that the United States has ever had. I mean, I think people who say that have partisan inclinations that overcome their judgment. I think Trump exceeded expectations in his first term. He took an American economy that had already begun to pull back from the financial crisis and accelerated it into a period of growth that was broad-based. And that lasted until the pandemic of 2020, of course.
The last 4 years, how have they been?
Great. Everything's great.
I liked his ideas about tariffs, about the economy, about trying to bring some of the businesses back from offshore.
He makes his followers feel like he's one of them. He inspires this kind of evangelism, the likes of which we have never seen.
They say, I have the most loyal people. Did you ever see that? Where I could stand in the middle of Fifth Avenue and shoot somebody and I wouldn't lose any voters, okay?
He's completely changed our expectations of American democracy and what can be done within it. He's a master craftsman of television and social media. The way he is able to communicate with people was unprecedented and I think is still unrivaled. He's also very critically given a completely new character to the Republican Party. It is his party now, not theirs.
This is Donald Trump's Republican Party. This is the Republican Party that will put America first.
He really has an iron-like grip on the political debate in this country, and he has made everyone, as a result of his leadership and campaigning, more engaged, more involved, more passionate about politics.